Okay, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome again. This week we have one of our graduates, Irmak, with us. Irmak is a PhD student at the Division of Robotics, Perception and Learning, KTH Royal Institute of Technology in Sweden. She's working with Yolanda Laite. She received her bachelor and master's degrees in computer engineering from our university. And while doing her master's degree, actually she worked with us at Cologne Research Laboratory. And her current research interests include human-robot interaction, computer vision, and deep learning. It's really nice to see you, Irmak, again. And looking forward to your presentation. The screen is yours.
Thank you so much for the great introduction. And thank you so much to give this opportunity to me. I am so happy and excited to be here with you today. Today, I'm going to talk about social robots that understand natural language instructions and resolve ambiguities. So, as we all know, verbal communication is a key challenge in human-robot interaction. But what are the challenges? Speech recognition is one of the main components, actually, in this challenge. But the existing applications works pretty okay to address the part of this challenge. On the other hand, natural language understanding still requires further exploration. So let's assume that a user asks robot to bring the green book in this scene. So firstly, the robot needs to identify that the user is asking the green book and it needs to find the objects that are fitting to the user's description. But what if there are more than one object fitting to that description? As in here, there are two green books. In that case, for an effective collaboration, the robots need to ask for follow-up clarifications instead of asking user to repeat the whole request again. So these are the main components we want to achieve in our project. Firstly, we would like to find the described scene regions in the user's description. And then, if there are ambiguities in the environment, we would like to ask follow-up clarification questions, like in here, which one, the one under the keyword or to the right of the monitor. In the user's request, people can identify objects with the help of referring expressions. What are these expressions? These expressions are the ones that are describing objects with their distinguishing features, like in here, the green book to the right of the monitor is one referring expression. So when we again go back to our steps, we would realize that the first step of our method, finding described scene regions, requires referring expression comprehension. And in the next step, to ask for follow-up clarifications, the robot needs to generate these expressions in the clarification question, like the one under the keyword or the to the right of the monitor. So let me start with referring expression comprehension. In the existing studies, in one method, spoken language instructions are mapped to actions and objects using long short-term memories. And in another work, again, the long short-term memories, LSTMs, are used in order to build the bridge between the visual input and the user expression. Moreover, generative adversarial networks, GANs, are also used to comprehend the referring expressions. In this study, the target object is selected among the given candidate objects. So what are the open challenges while generating referring expressions? Firstly, we realize that they haven't been tested in highly ambiguous real-world environments. Moreover, they assume target objects can be obtained from existing methods like object detection or localization methods, or they are given. But what if the object can't be detected with these detectors? Like in here, assume that the target objects are Brussels sprouts. So in that case, the existing object detection methods cannot detect this object. So this object wouldn't be in the candidate object list. So the existing methods would fail because this object is not in the candidate list, wouldn't consider as a candidate. So we realized that the existing studies didn't aim to resolve the problem of clarifying ambiguous user requests. Like if the user says the green vegetable, the robot wouldn't be able to distinguish which green vegetable it is. And if it is not able to ask for clarification, the task might fail. Lastly, we observed that most of the studies rely on flat RGB images, and they didn't consider the depth dimension of the objects. To address the first three challenges, we proposed a method leveraging explainability. For this purpose, we use GradCam explainability module, and this module generates the activation heat map in here, as you see, for different inference tasks, like if it can be image classification, image captioning, visual question answering, and it generates the heat map showing the relevant parts of the inference task. And this is applicable, this method is applicable to any CNN-based models. For our purpose, we use the image captioning module of the GradCam method. And this module generates the gradient of the captions log probability considering the last convolutional layer, and then it finds these activation heat maps for the given captions. We observe that when let's check the generated heat maps. We observe that whenever different captions are provided for the same scene, the activation heat maps will be on different areas. Like in here, if the expression is people walking on the beach, the activation heat map would be on the people part. But if it's the cow standing on the beach, it would be on the animal part, mostly. After this observation, to comprehend the referring expressions for a given scene and an expression, we firstly find the activation heat map using the GradCam explainability module. And then we computed the number of unconnected active regions in that activation heat map. And then we use this number to cluster the activation heat map using the k-means clustering. Finally, we select the clusters with the highest probability, with the highest activations, which shows the most probable target object regions. We suggested these ones as the candidates. Like this is the most active cluster, this is the second most, and this is the third most active cluster. To evaluate our method, we collected firstly 25 different images, and we asked an annotator to select one target object for each image. We informed the annotator to select the target object which is most difficult to describe in the scene, actually. And this data set contained three different types of difficulties. The first one is easy images. What is these easy images? In these images, all the objects were detectable by object detection methods, and there was only one destructor per target object. What we mean by destructor is that it's the object that is in the same type with the target object. Like there is just one destructor in here, like person, there are only two people in here. So just one destructor for this man. In the medium difficulty, it was still commonly known objects that can be detected by object detectors. But this time the number of destructors were at least three for the target object. Lastly, for the hard category, there were many uncommon objects in the scene, and there were many distractors for the target object. After this, collecting these scenes, we also collected some expressions describing the target objects. So we used MTurk workers in order to obtain these expressions. We informed the MTurk workers to describe the given target objects in the red bounding box in an unambiguous manner. Also, we informed the users to describe the objects as if they are describing it to a robot. This was done to ensure that each expression in the scene corresponds to an interaction, corresponds to a human-robot interaction. And we collected 10 expressions per image. So therefore, it yielded 250 expressions in total. And we considered these 215 expressions as different interactions. So let's move on to evaluation. In order to evaluate our method, we compared it with a state-of-the-art baseline for finding the described objects. We first obtained the first three candidate boxes from the baseline method and our method. And then we compute a matching score between these candidates and the target object. And we use one of the methods in the literature. In the in this matching score method, the first part ensures the maximum number of intersection areas, and the second part parallelizes the distance between the candidate between the distances in the candidate bounding box and the target object bounding boxes. So after finding these first three candidates and finding the matching score, we evaluate the proposed regions whether they can be used for asking for clarification questions. Let's move on our quantitative results. We observed that for the easy images, baseline method was performing significantly better than our method. And this was expected actually, because remember that in the easy images, the number of destructor objects were just one, and all these objects were detectable. All these objects were detectable by the existing object detection modules. Therefore, the chance level of the baseline is 50%, but it's very low for our method because we are considering all the regions of the scene, and all of the regions are candidate for us. So the chance level was super low. So the baseline was performing better than ours. However, when we checked the hard images where there were many destructors and they were uncommon objects, so it was difficult to detect these objects, our method was performing significantly better than the baseline method. Let's move on our qualitative results. Our qualitative results show that the regions proposed by our method matches with the ground truth, matches with the target objects. In here, the red bounding boxes are the target objects, and the green bounding boxes are the regions suggested by our method. And these expressions are the expressions provided by MTurk workers, original expressions. The interesting part in here is, for instance, this image. If we check this image, we realize that we see that the target object is this fish, but there are two fishes which are almost identical. And the user's description fits both of these fishes, basically. So in these cases, the output of our method contains partially both of these fishes. And in that case, actually, now the robot can ask for a clarification question only considering this region instead of considering the whole image, which can improve the effectiveness of the interaction. So we try to address these first three challenges in our first method. However, our method was still relying on flat RGB images and we weren't considering the depth dimension. However, let's check this image. When the expression is the mug next to the books, in 2D, one might consider that the closest mug to the books is the one in the blue bounding box. However, when we consider the depth dimension, we would realize that the mug in the red bounding box actually is closer than the other one. So the depth dimension in here plays a critical role to comprehend the referring expressions. So to address this challenge, we extended our work using the depth features, and we evaluated the performance of this system with the depth features. Again, we use GradCam explainability module to extend our work with the depth features. Actually, the image captioning module of the GradCam was trained on the flat RGB images, but we realized that whenever we provide them the depth image, it also generates some sensible heat map activations. For instance, in here, the activations are mostly on the microwave and on the table when the expression is the microwave closer to the table. So after this observation, we provide the scene and the depth image to GradCam explainability module individually, and we obtain two different heat map activations. Then we combined these heat map activations to find the common active areas in these two activation heat maps. After that, we follow the same procedure and we cluster these combined activations using k-means clustering. Again, we compute the number of unconnected active areas and we use this number in k-means clustering. Finally, the active clusters are suggested as the most probable target object regions. In here, the first, second, and the third one, when the expression is the ball next to the glass. So let's move on our evaluation. For our evaluation, again, we collected a data set with 70 images and 35 of these images is labeled as easy images. And for 35 of them were difficult images. In the easy images, the objects were described without the depth features. Like the object descriptions were not dependent on the depth feature. Like in here, the pen to the left of the banana. But for the difficult images, the objects were disambiguated by using the depth features as well. Like in here, the bottle with a yellow cap closest to the napkins. To understand which one is the closest to the napkins, we need the depth features as well. So after obtaining these scenes, we had two different conditions. In the RGBD method, we were considering the Gradscan with the depth features, the method I just described. And in the baseline, control condition, the method was without using the depth dimension, and it wasn't considering the depth features, and it was the first method that I described with explainability module, Gradcam explainability module. And the first method is described as RGBD method in the results, and the second one is provided as RGB method. Our quantitative results show that in the whole data set, depth features improved the comprehension significantly, actually. Whenever the depth features were provided to the method, the comprehension was significantly better. And in the difficult category also, we observed some significant improvements and they were more visible, actually. In the difficult category. Remember that in this category, the objects were described considering their depth features. We didn't observe any significant differences for the easy category. And this was expected again, because the object descriptions were not dependent on the depth feature in this case. Let's move on our qualitative results. Our qualitative results in here, again, the red ones are the ground truth, the target objects, and the green ones are the ones that are suggested by RGBD and RGB methods. And the first row is RGBD method outputs, and the second row is the RGB method outputs. In here, we realize that the lack of depth features mislead the RGB method to the destructor objects in here, as you see. However, RGB method was comprehending successfully the expressions. And these examples are from difficult category. So that was actually all about referring expression comprehension part. And if you have any questions about that part, maybe I can answer, or I can answer in the end if you prefer it. Okay, then I am going to move to referring expression generation part. Firstly, we try to comprehend the user's referring expression. And then if there are ambiguities, we need to generate these expressions. Now I am going to move our recent efforts. When we check the literature first, we would realize that the methods exist in the existing literature are generally relying on hand-designed rules and thresholds and algorithms to generate the referring expressions. And there are recent works to classify and to find the best referring expression generation algorithm. However, still these algorithms are based on hand-designed rules. And when we check the recent literature, we realize that recent studies employed deep learning. For instance, in this method, the target object and the contextual objects were used to generate referring expressions. In another study, perspective independent referring expressions were generated. What they mean by perspective independent was that they're generating referring expressions which are not tied to any particular viewpoints. Like instead of saying to the right, to the left, they were referring to objects like closer to, next to, this type of spatial relations. Oops. And when we check the open challenges in the existing literature, we realize, as we talked about, they were mostly focusing on hand design rules and thresholds. And they, again, they haven't been tested in highly ambiguous real-world environments. And lastly, they weren't taking the user's perspective into account while describing the objects. In this study, they were generating perspective-free referring expressions, but they weren't considering the user perspective while generating these expressions. So to address the first two challenges, we suggested a method to generate referring expressions in a natural and unambiguous manner. In our method, firstly, we detected the objects in the scene by using Mascar CNN module. Then these detected objects are provided into the first network, relation presence network, in order to find the spatial relations between objects. And the second network, and these obtained spatial relations then provided into the second network, relation informativeness network, to find the most informative relation describing objects in a natural and unambiguous manner. And by using the most informative relation, we generate an expression like this one, the book to the right of the mouse. And actually in this work, we were collaborating with Sinan Kalkan as well. And in our user study, to evaluate the generated expressions, we compared our method again with another state-of-the-art baseline in challenging 65 indoor and outdoor scenes. And we asked 61 human judges to evaluate the generated expressions. And they evaluate these expressions considering to correctly finding the described objects and also naturalness of the expressions. In the first study, correctly finding the refer objects, they were given a scene and with some object bounding boxes, and they were provided one expression describing one object in the scene, and we asked them to write the number of the object bounding box that is described in the expression, and they had a chance to say, "I couldn't identify the described object with the given expression." Our results show that compared to the baseline, people could find the described object more often in our condition. As we see in here, they could find the correct target objects, and they labeled our expressions as less unclear in their evaluation. Let's move on to the second experiment. In this experiment, they were given two expressions this time. And one of them is coming from the baseline method and the other one is coming from our method. And they were provided a scene. And in the scene, there was one target object and these expressions were describing that target object. And we asked them which expression you would prefer to use while describing this target object. Our results show that people preferred our method over the baseline to find the described objects. Also, they had a chance to say neither of the expressions were describing the objects or both of them were proper to describe the objects, but our method overperformed the baseline method. So in this method, we tried to address the first two challenges, but still our method was relying on single perspective and it wasn't considering the user's perspective while describing the object. So to address the last challenge, we extended our work with a perspective taking module and we evaluated its impacts to the interaction. Okay, this is the part I just described, referring expression generator, which generates the expression for a single scene. And we included perspective taking module to extend it. In the perspective taking module, firstly, we collected views of a scene from different viewpoints. From each viewpoint, we collected different scenes. And during the interaction, we detected user by using Masker CNN. And we extracted the depth of the user from the calibrated RGBD camera. Then we find the Euclidean distance between the user and each viewpoint. Then we use the view taken from the viewpoint closest to the user. So we find the view that's from the user's perspective, and we generate the expression using that scene. So as you see in here, now the robot was generating expressions like the bottle that you see to the left of the banana, instead of just saying the bottle to the left of the banana. So to evaluate the significance of our method, we conducted a user study with 89 participants. And we had two conditions. In the perspective taking condition, the paper robot was describing objects from the participant's perspective. And in the controlled condition, the robot was referring to the objects from its own perspective. So in this study, as you see, in perspective taking condition, the robot was saying something like the apple that you see to the left of the banana. And in the control condition, it was saying the apple that I see behind the mouse. So the robot was explicit about which perspective it's referring to. And in the experiment, the robot was describing one object in the scene and asking the user to pick up the described object from the table. And after picking up the object, the user was moving around the table to change its perspective for each description. As you see, it's rotating around the table during the experiment. So we had some hypotheses in this study. We firstly expected that people would spend less time while the objects were described from the user's perspectives. We also think that people would commit fewer mistakes in the perspective taking condition. Also, we thought that they would perceive the task as easier. And finally, we thought that people would perceive the robot's perspective taking competence and social presence abilities as better in the perspective taking condition when the objects were described from their perspective. Let's move on to the results. Firstly, we realized that, as expected, people spent less time in the perspective taking condition. Also, they committed fewer mistakes. Lastly, they perceived the task as easier. However, we didn't find any significant differences for the perception of robot in the study. They didn't perceive the robot differently in two conditions. So to conclude, firstly, to understand the natural language instruction, I described our recent efforts on referring expression comprehension. I firstly talk about leveraging GradCam explainability module in order to find the described objects. Then I described our latest efforts to find the described objects, considering the depth dimension and depth features. And then we move on generating referring expressions. And we talked about how we try to generate natural and unambiguous referring expressions. And lastly, we talked about the impacts of perspective taking to the spatial referencing during the interaction. And thank you so much for your kind attention. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Irmak. That was a really nice presentation. Really exciting problem and lots of problems to deal with. Lots of opportunities to make contributions. So I think that's a good research direction. Any questions from the audience?
I don't know why it was shorter than I thought, but I hope I try to explain everything properly. If there are any ambiguities in my presentation, I will be happy to clarify them.
I understood it very well. I knew some of the things. I think it was clear. So maybe you can comment on how you would like to proceed. So this is part of your PhD. How are you going to add on top of this
Actually, the latest efforts we did was about the referring expression comprehension part, not the generation part. So we are still planning to go towards that direction. And we are the next step we are now planning to do is how the interaction is affected when we provide also the generated heat maps, like how people's adaptation and how people's perception would change during interaction if we provide them the heat maps. Would their trust increase, for instance, when they see why the system made that prediction about these bounding boxes? That's the immediate next step we are planning to do. And we are also thinking about improving our method. For instance, one direction might be extracting the depth information from RGB methods. Instead of taking the RGB and the depth information, we are planning to find the depth first from the RGB image, then provide these ones. Also, we are planning to include some uncertainties to the system to improve the predictions and to increase the user trust and provide these ones also to the interaction.
Okay, very nice. So the salience maps. Okay, so the arrangement has changed. You obtain the salience map, then you obtain those clusters, and you don't apply a classifier on top of that, right?
No, we don't.
Okay.
That would be a great idea actually to apply a classifier to determine. Yeah. These ones, yeah.
I think you can use your salience map like a proposal generation method. Then you can have a classification scheme plus a regression branch there, like an object detector. Mm-hmm. And that can, I think, improve the results.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Also, as you see in our results, the object bounding boxes were not covering the target object exactly, like it was just partial. So maybe it can be improved with these methods as well, like just extending it with that.
We have Osman. Osman has a question from Australia.
Hey, Osman.
Merhaba. Hey, merhaba. Merhaba. It's great. I'm not in a good condition. It's a little bit late here. Very nice work, Ermak. So I just want to ask two questions. How do you choose K? K means clustering. And so the problem is dynamic. So how you choose K? Another question is, why not directly use instant segmentation? So you will get really good a segmentation for each object. So it will be solve this a bounding box problem.
These are both great questions, Osman. Thank you so much. And it shows that where I missed to explain actually. Just let me find my slides. Oops. Yes, in here. Why we are counting this number of active regions is that now we know that the activation heat map, and then we are counting the unconnected active regions in here. And we are counting the number of these unconnected active regions. Then we are using this number as the K in here. K for K means clustering. We are using this number, the number of unconnected regions. And for that, actually, yeah, it makes sense that we could use that ones, but now this is not a great example to show that, but for some scenes, the activation heat maps are very weird and there are many parts that look combined, but would you separate them or just use them as just one object? It's not that easy, it's not that straightforward. I'm so sorry to not to have that slide in here, but sometimes they are super combined together, so it's not easy to just segment them. Consider that there is one activation just next to here. Would you consider them as just one object or just the another two separate objects? Like, would you just focus on the red areas, or if the red area is just right there, is it a different region or the same region? That's why we were using k-means clustering in here.
My question is like, why don't you do the instance segmentation on the original image?
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, like you will have like separate like regions for each object, and then use grid cam on top of that. Like so you, the intersection part should be like your.
Uh-huh. Okay. You mean in the just directly from the input? Yeah. For that one, I am not sure, like, because we are working some cluttered scenes and we are working some like noisy images, I'm not sure whether it will be easy to segment them. Like, so for instance, Brussels sprouts, and for instance, this is a very noisy image if you can see it. So it's not that straightforward to understand. Actually, basically what GradCam understood in here is the green probably, and it tries to put some activation heat maps to the green part. So that's why we were trying to do, like, whenever it's the, can you bring the green vegetable, or do you, yeah, the user said that, and maybe the method doesn't know about the vegetable part, but it could understood it's a green object. So it's trying to highlight the areas in green. So for instance, in another example, let me show in our results. Sorry.
Yeah, I totally agree your point. Like, but if you narrow down your scenes to the, some kitchen or like a bedroom, mm-hmm. I think like, so instance segmentation will not be a big problem, but if mm-hmm. you scenes is like a variety, like mm-hmm. it will be like a hard problem. But if you can create like new, like a scenario, narrow down like your like environment mm-hmm. Context. And so like maybe some, this like a Cocoa office data set, something like that. And there, like if you do the instance segmentation, maybe you can get like a very high accuracy.
Mm-hmm,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That makes a lot of sense. In here, actually, why we were motivated to work with this problem was that many of the works were working on whenever it's just stable environments that are controlled environments. But we were thinking in the wild, whenever since my PhD is more towards human-robot interaction, like in the real-world environments, in the real-time interactions, it's difficult to control the whole environment, and it's dynamic, and it's not easy to just segment sometimes. That's why actually we approach the problem like that. And I wanted to say before was that, for instance, when the expression was this one, you can't see the second candidate, but the second candidate was on the sky because it was saying blue house between the green and red houses, and the second blue thing in here was the sky. So there are a lot of things that we can improve our method, like as you suggested, like at least segmenting objects instead of, if it's not a proper object, maybe don't consider that area. It makes a lot of sense, but the general motivation of this method is if you don't understand part of the expression, if there are some mistakes in the speech recognition part, for instance, and so you couldn't understand the object name. Now you can still find some sensible areas fitting to the description, and now you can ask the user to clarify what was the exact target object.
Thank you, Irmak, for explanation. Great
Thank
work.
Thank you. Thank you, Osman.
Any other questions? Otherwise, we can stop recording and proceed informally. Okay, thank you, Irmak, again. That was a nice presentation.
Thank you so much.
We will continue informally.